Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for coming tonight. I would love to welcome you to the Center for Jewish History. My name is Rachel Lithgow, and I'm the director of the American Jewish Historical Society, one of the sponsors of this evening. It's always very special to have a partnership with another Jewish academic or really any kind of institution that you really believe in. And I'm pleased to once again be partnering with my good friend Rochelle Saidel at the Remember the Women Institute, and also to be a part of this kind of historic aspect of Remember the Women, because tonight they are launching their Women Theater in the Holocaust Resource Handbook, which I'm very excited. Rochelle has been really on the cutting edge of Holocaust education, particularly as it pertains to women and sexual violence, and now bringing culture and art into the mix. It's really, she's done really remarkable work. And if you haven't gotten to know Rochelle, you really should, because she's great. She is. We at the American Jewish Historical Society are the keepers of American Jewish history. We like to refer to ourselves as the future of the American Jewish past. In this building at the Center for Jewish History, we are but one of five partner organizations, the others being the American Sephardi Federation, Yeshiva University Museum, the Leo Beck Institute, and the YIVO Institute for Jewish Research. In this beautiful 155,000 square foot building, we house just our small piece of the archival collection, includes about 30 million documents, photographs, and objects that detail American Jewish life from 1654, when Jews first arrived in America, to today and tomorrow. We are collecting at an institutional rate. We collect family records. We have just signed with organizations like Hias to be the stewards, and the American Jew and Hadassah to be the stewards of their collections. So we really are thinking about our history and how to preserve it and push it out into the public. And one of the ways we do that is by having public programs like this. So I want to thank the Center for always being a wonderful partner. It's CEO Joel Levy, who's here with us tonight. Thanks for being here, Joel. I appreciate it. The evening tonight is going to be divided into three parts. We'll have a dramatic presentation, we'll have the launch of the handbook, and then we'll have a very short discussion in which I'll ask the panelists here tonight maybe one or two questions each. And then we can go out and enjoy some conversation and refreshment. So I'm very grateful to you all for being here. And without further ado, let me introduce my dear friend, Rochelle Saidel.
Good evening to everyone. Rachel, thank you so much for the wonderful introduction. Thank you to you and American Jewish Historical Society for working with us. It's always a pleasure, and personal one as well as a professional one. And the staff that are here working with us too, Yoni and Shirley, have been great. And also I want to acknowledge that Joel Levy, who is the CEO of the Center for Jewish History, which is housing us in this wonderful auditorium, is here. We're glad you're with us. I want to thank, the first thing I'm doing now is really introducing the dramatic presentation, which is the first part of the program. And I want to make it very clear that all of our wonderful performers, singer, actors, pianist, are volunteers, and they're all professionals in their fields, and they're really wonderful because I just saw them rehearse, so you're in for a treat. And I want to try and explain this a little bit. There are three short dramatic presentations, and they are going to flow together without a break with a narrator. But I want to, you need to understand, the first one we're going to present is Gretel Bergmann, and that is a contemporary play. It's performed by Stacey Linartz and is written by Cynthia Cooper, who is here. playwright. And you're going to hear from her later on the panel. This one-woman play tells the true story of a German-Jewish athlete who encounters anti-Semitism in sports in Germany in the early 1930s. She leaves for England, and she's faced with some dilemmas when the 1936 Olympics in Germany are underway. Now, this is going to be followed by a play that is a really historic play. Cynthia wrote the Gretel Bergmann recently, but the next excerpts were written in 1944 in Ravensbrück concentration camp. It's one of the first plays that we have that were preserved, and it's quite remarkable. It was written by Germaine Tillion, who was a French political prisoner, and it was written in French in the camp to raise the spirits of the women. And director Meghan Brodie, Dr. Meghan Brodie of University of Southern Maine, was able to do something so extraordinary, including for me personally. She got this play translated from French into English, and I had been struggling with reading it in French, and then she sent it to me in translation. So I went to bed reading French and woke up reading English, and for that alone, I'm grateful, Meghan. But the point is that this play, she put it on in University of Southern Maine with her students last year. It was amazing. She'll talk more about it during the panel later. The play was written as a highly stylized comic opera. The author, Germaine Tillion, was a very educated woman. She was an anthropologist, and she was in the underground in France and ended up in Ravensbrück. This play has a Brechtian tone, I am told, and this adaptation that we're going to hear tonight was created specially for tonight because it's a long play. We're hearing just excerpts, songs, and a monologue. So I also wanted to say the names of our actors, our singer. We have Stacey Linhartz and Lynn and Silver as the actors, and Lily Davis as the singer. And again, they have also generously volunteered their time and talent for us and for you, as does Jonathan Morrow, who is the pianist and taking care of the musical direction. The last part is a very short poem, also from a play written by Cynthia Cooper, Silence Not a Love Story. And the poem is called Wild Wind Blows. It's about a German-Jewish resistance worker, Giza Piper Konopka, and it is performed also by Stacey Linhartz, and as I said, musical direction accompaniment by Jonathan Morrow. And I cannot thank you all enough, as well as other people here. And as I mentioned, Cynthia Cooper and Meghan Brodie and the other people I'll thank now, I don't know if I'll have an opportunity later, are Karen Schulman, my co-author of our resource book, Dr. Sonja Hedgepeth, who will be on the panel, and we work very, very closely together all the time, and Maria, I'm not going to do this, Cianabus, is that reasonable, came with Meghan from Maine, and she was the choreographer when they produced the play last year, and all of you, thank you very much. I think it's time now to go on with the show.
Sometimes I think the hardest thing to be an athlete is not to be an athlete. We do not so much choose to be an athlete, it is just what we are. And the times when we are what we are, an athlete, everything comes together. The body and the soul, the heart and the mind. As we race across the dirt of a track, blood rushing, feet flying. And the times when we are not an athlete, when we cannot be an athlete, it, what shall I say? It bristles against the bones. There is no other way to explain. It is like the other things that we are. We are born a woman or a man. We are born with blue eyes or brown. We are born a Gentile or a Jew. As for me, I was always crazy for sports. When I was growing up in Laufein, I played on all the boys' teams. In 1930, I won 6 track and field ribbons. High jump was my best event. I was determined to be a world-class athlete. I set my sights on the university in Berlin to become a teacher of physical education. Guten Tag, I am Fräulein Gretel Bergmann. I have looked over the list of registrants at the university, but I do not find my name. Oh, yeah, I have my acceptance letter right here. I do not understand when you tell me something has changed. My record is good. Chancellor Hitler has said not to admit Jews. Well, how long must I wait for the climate to change? I wish to continue sports now, in my best years. Yeah. I understand there's nothing you can do. I would not give up athletics so easily. I went to England, the London Polytechnic. It was a very good thing. I won the blue ribbon in the high jump, 1934. I was the champion in all of Britain. I was a world-class athlete. It was soon after that my father came to England on a business trip, he said. His eyebrows were tight on his forehead, even as he greeted me. Papa, why must you be so serious? Look, my new ribbon. Well, yes, I have heard that Hitler is bent on having a fanfare for the Olympics of 1936. It is of no concern to me. So, if the Americans say they will not come because of discrimination against the Jews, it is a true thing. A Jew cannot so much as join a track club. Come back. It doesn't interest me. I have a future here. I don't care if Hitler wants all the German Jewish athletes to try out. I don't care if I am the best athlete. What? No, Papa, shh, what is it? Threats. They're making threats against me. Who do they threaten? They make threats against the Jews and against the families. Yeah, Papa, I understand. I understand how it is. I went back to Germany. 21 Jews were invited to try out for the Olympics. Of course, we could not train in the same way as the Aryan athletes, but we worked hard all the same. In 1935, only 2 of us were left on the German Olympic team. I was one. The other was Helene Meyer, the fencer whose grandfather was a Jew. It's so funny that by the religion, a Jew is one with a Jewish mother, but to the Nazis, anyone with Jewish blood was a Jew. Miss Bergmann, Jewish high jumper on German Olympic team. Change in Nazi philosophy to admit Jews. U.S. votes to join Olympics. American boys will have their birthright of competition, and so on and so on. But I was busy, working out, running, jumping. In June, only 2 months before the Olympics, I equaled the high jump records, 5 feet, 3 inches. Everybody on the team buzzed that I would win a silver or a gold. There was an air of excitement everywhere in Germany about the Olympics that summer. Even the Jewish shop owners were allowed to fly the flag for the Olympics. A big parade was scheduled. The very first Olympic torch was going to be lit. All of Berlin had a spit, polish, shine. Soon the word came. The Americans set sail. The big games were practically on. In July, July 16th it was, 2 weeks before the Olympic Games, I received the letter from the German sports authorities. Fräulein Bergmann, this letter is to advise you that your achievements have been inadequate, and we have found it necessary to remove you from the German Olympic team. Please depart from the Olympic training grounds immediately. I was an athlete with no place to compete. No birthright of competition. I left Germany not long after with $10 in my pocket. So, I have said it is hard to be an athlete and not to be an athlete. But sometimes one must live by another thought as well. At the medal ceremony in Berlin, all of the German athletes were required to wear a swastika and raise their arms in a Nazi salute. They even said the words Heil Hitler. It bristles against the bones. That I could not do. And so I say to myself, Margaret, perhaps sometimes it is easier on the conscience not to be an athlete after all. We are inside a barracks in Ravensbrück concentration camp, a women's camp in northern Germany. The prisoners are divided into two groups, the old and the young. Only here your age is not determined by how many years you have lived, but by how long you have been in the camp. The young are easily recognized by their newly shaved heads, while those who have survived months, and in some cases, years, have little else to distinguish them from anyone else but the color of their hair. These women try to comfort the new arrivals and teach them the ways of the camp.
I was told you must resist. I said yes, so they wouldn't persist. Countryside by the northern train route we'd cross. They left no seat for me at no extra cost. Need no passport, need no ticket, need no voucher to make this express train departure. Yet in spite of this wayfaring novelty, I would have preferred to flee. Listen, young verfugbar, to the jailbird singing in the street. It's on this tune you'll see why you've appeared to me. Watchdog is barking, warden is yelling, stomach's growling greedily. Meet your worst nightmare vis-a-vis. First they took my necklace, my earrings, my rings, and my pendant. Then they took my suitcase, and as transit tax, they took my shirt and slacks. They left no scraps. come to work, here you never eat, there is never any sleep. See how the sower reaps, pray for your soul to keep. When at last you're finished, torn down, diminished, nothing left of you but shoes, your fat will be put to good use.
For what?
To make soap, to grease the locomotives.
It's winter now. We are at the Bekleidung, where the prisoners are forced to sort and stack the loot collected by the SS from across occupied Europe. The women are surrounded by piles of bags, old boots, torn underwear, furs, beautiful table linen, baskets of dishware, silverware, and even a mechanical horse. The remains of many homes from many miles away. To pass the time, Rosine tells her fellow prisoners the story of a mythical prisoner named Sympathy.
Sympathy, poor dear. She was very exhausted. Then they took her to the Blakova. Not to the pretty face, but the bitch. And the bitch said, "I'm going to punish her." We warned her. But that did nothing. Then they took her back to the Blakova. Not to the bitch, but to the pretty face. Now, the pretty face said, "Let's use the nightstick." They used the nightstick. That did nothing. Then they took her to the guard, not the dolt, but the tamer. The tamer said, "We have to give her a black eye." They gave her a black eye, and that did nothing. Then they took her back to the guard, not the tamer, but the dolt. The dolt said, "We have to send her to the Riviera infirmary." They dragged her to the infirmary, poor Sympathy. There was a tall, string beanie SS doctor sitting on the table. "We have to give her a sick pass." They gave her a pass. That did nothing. Then they took her back to the infirmary, not to the string bean this time, but to Nurse Erica. "We have to give her a kick in the butt." That's what she said in her language. They did that. They even gave her two. And that did nothing. Then they took her to the SS man, not the boxer, but the Hungarian. The Hungarian said, "We have to give her to the ferocious, unmuzzled dog." They gave her to the ferocious, unmuzzled dog. That made her run. Just a little bit, that's all. Then they went to the commandant, not the redhead, but the officer. And the officer said, "She has to go to the Bougonnais." Le Bougonnais, that means they put you in a windowless hole where you stay 4 days without soup, 1 day with soup, 4 days without soup, and so on and so on. They put her in the pit, poor Sympathy, and that did nothing. Perhaps she was somewhat more exhausted than before. Then they dragged her back to the commandant, not the officer, but the redhead. The redhead said, "Let's take her to the Strassblock." They took her to the Strassblock. That did nothing. Then they took her to the liar, not the big one, the little one. The little one said, "There is going to be a D-Day." And there was a D-Day. That did nothing. She had seen everything, you know. That even made her laugh. Then they took her to the liar, not the little one, but the big one. And the big one said, ha, 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 we have to give her the armistice. They gave her the armistice. That cured her of her exhaustion, just like that.
Far worse than work at the Bekleidung, sorting loot, is the Planirung work of flattening the earth. Some women are yoked to giant cement rollers as part of this forced labor. The rest, with their shovels and wheelbarrows, toil alongside each other. And yet, despite the despair that characterizes life in the camp, the women remain steadfast in their hope of surviving another day.
Since these jealous guardians cannot be compelled to mercy, oh, then should we be left to count our pains and torments? When wild the wind blows over darkened fields, we only feel the clear, wide space. When darkened clouds press full of threat, in us now grows a calm, strong as a tree. Behind us lies the burden of long years. Behind us all the sorrow we have suffered. There is the goal. Yet one hesitates. So far the way, and everywhere are stones. When will it start? The dawn of the day when humanity turns to the light. Yet it may be, whenever it may be, I will work hard as if the time has come today. Remember. Remember. Remember this also when you are old.
before we continue, I wanted to again thank everybody who participated in this wonderful dramatic presentation. And we have the actors, the singer, the pianist, music director, and stagehand, and Meghan Brodie, who directed the play from Ravensbrück, and Cynthia Cooper, who wrote the segment of the poem, and the Gretel Bergmann. So could the two of you stand up? Yeah, I think so. And I also wanted to say, I don't know everybody who's here, but I do know that there are at least two daughters of Ravensbrück survivors and one granddaughter. So I wanted to acknowledge that too, and if there are more of you, you'll tell me later, but I know about these three, and I think it's very special to have you with us. Well, we are here to launch our handbook, which I worked on with my co-author and my right-hand person, who is Karen Schulman, and I'm left-handed, so it's very important to have a right-hand person. And we're going to show you some of it, and I think Karen's supposed to start before I do, according to this. You want me to do that before you talk? Karen thinks I should tell you how this project started. In the publicity before this evening, it listed another person on the panel later, Moti Sandak from Tel Aviv, and he is unfortunately not here. Among other things, he has pneumonia, so he's not here. But about 2 years ago, I met with him. At one point, Sonja Hedgepeth was with me meeting with him as well. I don't know if it was the first meeting or the second meeting, but I met with him so many times in Jerusalem. He's from Tel Aviv. He has a project online called All About Jewish Theater, and he's been working a lot, and he's got a very interesting amount of work on his website, but it's not at all done because he's trying to create this massive encyclopedia about theater and the Holocaust. And he asked us at Remember the Women Institute to create the segment for him about women and theater and the Holocaust. And we said we'd do it, and Karen and I started working on compiling plays and so on and so forth. And he said that he was going to be ready to launch his encyclopedia in 2014 and then 15 and then 16. It's a huge, huge project. And we worked very hard, and we're pretty efficient. And we were basically done with the unit on women theater and the Holocaust. So he agreed. I said, look, we don't want to hold this back from anybody that might be needing to use this, teachers, anybody interested, and so on and so forth. So we're going to launch this separately. And when you're ready, please feel free to incorporate it. So that's exactly what happened. And as of today, this is live. Are you going to explain that? Karen will explain it because she's much better at technical things than I am. So I'm going to turn this over to Karen Schulman. And
I'm going to sit down. Sure, sit down. We are so pleased that all of you are here to with us to celebrate the launching of our Women, Theater, and the Holocaust, a resource handbook. We jumped at the opportunity when Moti said that he was going to create something much larger than this. But we thought that this is something that, as an institution, we can really create something that's a living document. We believe that through, I guess it was about 2 years that we've been compiling. Once people started hearing what we were doing, people emailed, we were told tons of plays. We have so much information in this resource handbook, and we're excited to continue to get more and more information to make sure that this is a living document and a usable document. So we hope that teachers, anyone really can use this document in their classrooms, with their families, as we saw with those three short performances, the power that theater has to tell a story. And we're excited to be part of that. So the resource handbook right now lives on our rememberwomen.org page. It's easy to find. You just have to download it. We have, this is our table of contents. Oh, I had to remember, our cover was created by Bonnie Greenfeld, so we're very thankful for that. So, this is the table of contents. There's an introduction by Rochelle Saidel. She really goes into a lot of why we created this, and again, the power of theater to tell the story that we wanted to be able to tell. So the main part of this is an annotated bibliography. I will show you what that looks like. So this is the introduction. Also, all of the red, they're all links. So they're live links that you can just hit it and it'll take you to wherever you want to go, which is helpful, we hope. That was a painstaking process and we hope you use it. Hopefully the links will work, fingers crossed. So the first section is our annotated bibliography. So the first part are plays about women during the Holocaust. So it's in alphabetical order. It has the name of the play, when it was published, and really as much information that we were able to find in a concise, usable manner. So again, each one has, if we could find links, they take you to wherever you want to go, which is helpful, we hope. So that's the first section. The second section are plays about the Holocaust written by women. Again, we think it's really important to explore the stories of women and explore the stories told by women. So that's a really important piece of this handbook. The third part, as we went through this, we found that there are numerous books about theater and the Holocaust. So we wanted to make sure that this was also part of our resource handbook. Next is section two. We have, thankfully, where is she? Hello. Dr. Meghan, Brodie wrote a beautiful, beautiful piece about her experience of working and directing the performance of In the Underworld, which we saw a little bit about just then. We linked to her website, which I definitely suggest people check it out. There are beautiful photos, extraordinary photos, and her narrative is really beautiful to read, so we suggest you look at that. The last part, with any good resource handbook, we want to make sure that we give some advice on how to use it. So this specifically was created with the help of my husband, who's also a history teacher. And what we did was we tried to look through how can teachers use this in the classroom, because you know a piece is only as good as it's being used. So we use some of the New York City framework of how you can translate it into the classroom, and we hope that we hear from any teacher who uses it in the classroom to hear how it goes. With this entire piece, we hope that you feel like us, it's a collaborative process, and hopefully we will update it as much as we'll need to, probably maybe twice a year or so. With advice and just anecdotes and whatever we can find. So this is our resource handbook. We're thrilled that you're here to launch it, and I definitely suggest you go home, go to our website, and download it. Thank you.
Very good. Why don't you put it back to the cover?
Sure.
Because I don't know how to do that.
I'll do it.
Okay.
I'm on it.
That's it. I don't know what you just did.
We're good.
Okay. Okay. Thanks, Karen. I think it's about time for our panel, and Rachel's going to introduce the panelists. I just want to again say, from our homepage, rememberwomen.org, you'll find how to get to this PDF, which is free and downloadable, and you're welcome to please look at it and to use it. And we'd love to have some feedback and see what you think, too. Okay.
Thank you very
much.
Hello. Thank you, Yoni. I don't think it matters.
All right, I'll sit next to
you. You sit next to me. So Rochelle Saidel is going to be part of our panel. She's one of the creators of the Remember the Women Institute. She's written extensively on women and the Holocaust and sexual violence. She also has a particular speciality on Ravensbrück concentration camp, and really wrote the definitive text on women in Ravensbrück and on that camp. So I can think of really no one better to sit on this panel, actually. Cynthia Cooper, whom she briefly gave an introduction for, is a playwright and has been for many years and wrote two of the pieces that you saw this evening. Meghan Brodie is the assistant professor of theater at the University of Southern Maine, and she directed the production that you saw a couple of images of and heard. And finally, Sonja Hedgepeth, who is a professor of Holocaust studies and women's studies, language and literature at Middle Tennessee State University, and she's been a longtime collaborator with Rochelle. They together wrote, really, again, the definitive text on sexual violence and women in the Holocaust, which if you haven't read, I won't say it's a good read in the sense that it's pleasurable, but it really is an extraordinary text, and they launched it several years ago and had a wonderful, wonderful conference at USC where they really created a real community of people talking about this issue for really the first time in a public and academic forum, and it was really a remarkable thing. So we should really be indebted to them for that. I want to start with Cynthia. So, you know, women in theater is always, I mean, this could be a discussion we could have all day long, right? About how women are represented, how women direct, how women write, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm just curious, we did here on this very stage in the fall, a very interesting panel and a conversation about reinserting women into the historical narrative, right? Because there's a lot of history that's not written by women, and oftentimes the women die, right? Or they're not part of the story, or they don't have the power or the resources to be a part of that story historically. So it's great to see that narrative, you know, come full circle here. And I'm curious if you'd like to, and this is kind of a big question, but sort of where do you see, you know, women in theater now and sort of how that affects stories that get told?
Okay, well, that's a big ongoing conversation right now. And there are some other playwrights here, I think. If you could just, like, raise your hand. And I think there are some other artists here of other disciplines. I think what's happening with women in theater, I think there's, Rochelle, I don't think she knew this, but brought together a brilliant convergence of issues. Because when you talk about the women in the theater part, there is kind of a silencing of voices that has happened in the theater. And I think that it affects the stories that we hear. So the things that this is doing to bring women's voices forward is really amazing and an incredible contribution to what is becoming a little mini movement, although it's been a movement for a long time. Women are vastly underrepresented in the theater, that doesn't mean that there are not a lot of women playwrights. There are an overload of women playwrights. Sometimes they talk about the pipeline. I'm like, the pipeline is like, you know, the BP pipeline on the Gulf Coast. It's bursting with people and with talent. Nonetheless, several studies in a row have shown that women are produced at about 20% of the new plays, and that's not, you know, taking out Shakespeare and all that, are by women. And that this is so, even though the audience is 60% women, or on Broadway now, it's 68% women, and actually the numbers are even lower. Women have about 11% in the best years, maybe that's one or two plays on Broadway. And that's also true when you add in the Shakespeare and all that, you get up to maybe 25% or 27% representation by women at the best. There was just a study that came out last week in San Francisco called Not Even. There's a study by the League of Professional Theater Women earlier, about 2 months ago, they came up with the same statistics, 25%. And this goes nothing has changed for about 15 or 20 years. In 1998, there was a big study by the New York State Council on the Arts, and this is the home of the arts, so, and it showed that women were at 19 or 20% of plays produced. So that's playwrights. Directors have similar problems. It also affects the roles for actors. The study in San Francisco showed that very comprehensive, that women write more roles for women. And I think women speak more from a different place, not always from the perspective of a woman, but they have a different perspective to bring, and that has been silenced in a different way. And I think what has the consequence of that is that we get to hear a lot about Cinderella, but we aren't really hearing some of the really important stories that affect women, some of the stories that affect women's human rights, that can change the conversation on topics, that can help deepen people. I mean, I believe that the theater is one of the few art forms that is actually transformational. It's like going to synagogue. You know, you pray. But in here, you listen to people, you hear their voices, you hear ideas, and it allows people to process emotion and to actually come out thinking something and feeling something different than when they went in. That is amazing. So I think that this is a huge contribution to many other people that are trying to move forward the conversation for women and getting gender parity. Tomorrow, by the way, is Equal Pay Day. We're not even talking about equal pay because nobody's getting paid much in the theater. We're talking about equal opportunity and equal representation of our philosophy and our points of view. So that's my...
Equal pay can be the next hurdle for women in the theater.
Pardon?
Equal pay can be the next hurdle once
women in
the theater
right. When we get our... You know, 20%, when you think about 20%, if there's an election and somebody gets 20% of the vote, we say that they lost by a landslide. You know, 20% is like this little corner here. And the rest of y'all are the men playwrights, and mostly white men. I mean, so women and people of color have just been systematically excluded from theater in really frustrating ways.
No, thank you. That's it's such an important point. And all, you know, it was interesting to see the presentation because, you know, women are also very underrepresented, you know, historically in the narrative and in our collections. We've recently launched at AJHS an initiative to create a processing and digitization of historic women's institutes, archives, collections, including the Jewish Foundation for the Education of Women, which none of you maybe have heard of, but they've been giving scholarships to Jewish women for 135 years. So it's a really, I mean, these are really remarkable organizations that have a rich history. That organization in particular has, you know, letters of recommendation for these young women written by Mark Twain, written by Grover Cleveland, and we just don't hear those stories, and they're really important stories to be told, and so we're looking forward to continuing this work, and it's wonderful to see you do that work in the theater, so thank you. I want to ask Meghan, so, you know, producing a Holocaust play at the college level is different than producing a Thornton Wilder play. Right?
Yes.
Yes. Right? It's not Hair. It's not Our Town. You know, this is kind of what the kids want to. And so here you come bringing, you know, in the underworld. Here, this is what we're doing. I'm wondering if you could maybe talk a little bit about how that was to work with students on a production like this and how they were able to kind of wrap their heads around not Our Town?
Absolutely. Well, when I came to the department with this, the promotions person said, so I'm selling this as a darkly comic Holocaust operetta, Meghan? Exactly what is that going to look like, and who's going to come see that? So it is a really unique piece of art, I think, and it is also an historical artifact. So a lot of people just said, oh, well, she just directs the stuff by women, so we'll just let her do her thing and see how that turns out. So I auditioned all undergraduate students, largely between the ages of about 18 to maybe 26, and on their callback form, it asked them if they would be willing to shave their head if they were cast. And they, to a person, said yes. And I thought, well, maybe this is just because they really want a role. I'm gonna see how this plays out. And I said, I cast the show, and half of the cast, the people new to the camp, needed to have their head shaved. And we had a conversation about that. And someone, not a member of the cast, said, well, you could use bald caps. And I said, we could do any number of things. It's theater. But to honor these women's lives, this is the right thing to do. And every single cast member said, yes, absolutely. And for an 18-year-old woman who is just getting to college to agree to shave her head when she wants to be professionally marketable and has a bunch of male professors and male students telling her if she shaves her head, she will never be cast until it grows back, is a really big deal. And Rochelle, I think, joined us, was it shortly before or after?
Before.
Shortly before, and we had planned to have someone come in and do it, but we were gonna do it as a group.
After the heads were shaved, yes.
So about before or after the, right. 3 days before we were going to do it, the cast came to me, and they said, Professor Brodie, we're totally cool to do this, but we want to shave each other's heads because we have this sense of solidarity, and they wanted to donate their hair. And I totally lost it then. I might lose it now. And we worked through the process, and it was an incredible moment for all of them. And I'll tell you, it happened last April, and every single cast member I noticed on Facebook a couple weeks ago posted that this was the anniversary of that production that changed their lives. And so they were not familiar with Holocaust history. This was something really new to them. Most of them grew up in Maine. They did not have extensive Holocaust history in their high schools, if at all. And so we started with the fact that Holocaust denial exists, and how frightening is that? Let's just start there. And then we had to work through things like, what is life like in a concentration camp? What were death camps like? Who was in a concentration camp? Why might we be there? And we sat at a table and we discussed the fact that half of us would have ended up in a camp, whether it be for religious reasons, political reasons, or our sexuality. And that was a really sobering moment for all of us. And they said that what they wanted to do, and this was my ultimate hope for them, but it had to come from them, was that they wanted to carry these women's stories with them for the rest of their lives so that they could share them with others, because they recognized that they can't be forgotten and that no one knew. And so they are all incredibly articulate young women who can tell you about the women of Ravensbrück and about the women after whom they modeled their own characters. They researched women and then used those women as a basis for their characters. Tillion's script is not comprehensive in that way, and so we did a lot of table work, and we worked together quite a bit. We would come in, we watched documentaries together, and it was probably one of the most transformative experiences of my entire life, working with these 13 young women. And we had an all-female cast, we had female designers, and we had Jonathan Morrow, who was our music director and adapted the lyrics. Our translators came from Philadelphia, Christophe Modeau, who wrote, who composed some music and arranged some music for the Paris premiere in 2007, flew in to watch the production. It was the first production to have a woman play the lead. In most of the European productions, it was played by a man. It was quite an event for all of them, and it's something that we are all working on to find a way for it to have more life and to reach a much broader audience. Tillion was one of 7,000 women released from the camp through the American Red Cross, and 3 days later, the bulk of the women who were left were sent on a forced death march. So it's through a three-day window of time that we even have this play that was smuggled out through a friend because she smuggled out a roll of film documenting medical experiments on women in the camp. I honor her life and am honored that I had a chance to do it with those young women. I'm sorry.
Thank you. That's incredible. Thank you. And that's certainly something they will carry with them and to their children and to et cetera, et cetera. So it's really, we really gave them a great gift.
Thank you.
Sonja, as an educator and a college professor, Karen said it very well, which is that a resource is only as good as its user, right? So I'm curious as to how you could concretely implement this document, right, into your regular classroom. I mean, there are a lot of, I saw that the Jewish Women's Archive, is part of that when you click these links. By the way, that archive is with us and linked in our portal, and we do a lot of work together. So there's all kinds of neat connections there, but I wonder how you could start with this document, in the classroom and beyond.
Thank you. Well, I have been teaching about the Holocaust at my institution since 1989, and in 1999, I started a course on women and the Holocaust, and I will be teaching it this coming fall. So it's really apropos, and I really am so thankful for this resource handbook, because I must confess that among the many materials I have to choose from, I have never chosen a play for the course on women and the Holocaust. So that speaks exactly to what goes on. It's also a form of ignorance or not thinking about how theater really can give a voice, especially to women. And I'm really considering after this, the resource handbook and listening to everyone and the actors and the music, that we might do a reader's theater, because especially for women, as you know, it's very hard to hear your voice thrown into the room and saying, oh, are they really listening to me? And I think that just by the way of having women do that in a classroom, it activates them instead of being passive receivers of this information. And certainly we have evidence, we're hearing about this from Meghan, for instance, or Cynthia said that, there's interest in Cinderella. I would say that often I find my students, especially the women, and there are a few men who take the course, that they're really from Frozen, and they need to be unfrozen. And I need to be unfrozen as well, okay?
Don't we all?
Yeah, so this is really a one-stop shopping affair. And any educator, the more that educators find out about this, this will catch fire. And I'm thinking, Karen, of something that you have in the last part. I'm certainly you formulated it with David. And it's very important. It's one question you pose to teachers, and that is ask students, whatever level they're studying, how did a piece of theater you saw, a play, how did it affect you? And I'll tell you, I should not have expectations, but I teach in an area where I will not fall out of my chair when some students say, I've never been to a play. So let me assure you that part of an assignment, should that come up, is that they go to a play, or we go to a play on campus. It's that rudimentary, so that one becomes part of something that is living. And certainly it's so easy to become part of the dead, if you understand what I mean. So that is something really tangible that I see it. I'm so happy for this resource handbook.
Could they go to a play by a woman?
And on our campus.
We can start early. Well.
Yes.
We've tried, and I think it's so important that you bring this up, because we've tried to, you know, part of our mission is, it's very difficult, right, to sell an archive to the public, don't you know? So, right, because we're not a museum, but we're an archive that masquerades as a museum. So we do museum-like things. So we do exhibitions sometimes, and we do public programs like this. And so we're trying to push out this historic material. And so one thing that we've done, not very successfully yet, in the sense that we haven't gotten, you know, huge audiences yet, but is that we've done this twice now, is that we've taken historic material, and for example, we did an exhibit called By Dawn's Early Light, which was the contribution of Jews to very early American culture. And we took the poetry and theater section, because there was some wacko stuff written in colonial America by Jews who were struggling between being Jewish and being American, and what does that mean, and you know, you know, Noah wrote some significant plays, and so there were a lot of female poets. Certainly, you know, Ida Menken, who was this kind of very colorful character in that era, and theater actress, and all of these interesting things. And we took excerpts from these plays, including one in which the Jews assassinate the Pope. That's right. So it really, really very out there stuff, and we did a stage reading, right? And we had actors read the historic text, and we had some multimedia as well. And I think it was really, and you know, we'd never done it here. And then we did it in conjunction with the Center for World War I, where we had letters from the soldiers' front, letters from Jewish chaplains, and it was a really interesting experiment that I hope we do more of. It's very important for us. Well, you know, we try here at the center. So I want to kind of ask Rochelle a question, and then maybe open it up to all of you to ask these lovely women whatever you'd like. You know, Yom HaShoah is upon us, and I'm curious, Rochelle, how this handbook, in a particularly American context, right? Because we don't really have these kinds of conversations. Women in the Holocaust, we've had this discussion many times, are very underrepresented. It's kind of the final frontier. How does this handbook really contribute and invite people to remember the Holocaust in a specific way?
Well, I think it's an important question, because we're at a time when we need resources such as dramatic presentations to be remembering, and more and more, it's so moving. I mean, we all were moved by what we saw this evening, and I have to say that not only Meghan and her students' lives were changed and moved by this production last year, but I went up to Maine and I sat with the students and I saw the play, and I just couldn't get over either the play or the students. And one of them drove me about a half an hour from where I was staying to the university, and another one drove me back. And with the shaved heads, and talking about the shaved heads, and telling me exactly what Meghan said, how they chose a woman to model themselves after, and they told me the whole story of the woman. It was incredible for me. And I mean, I've been working on Ravensbrück since 1980, like I know a lot, but this was absolutely the most moving thing I'd ever seen, and it was theater. And this also brought us all together tonight, this whole project, because I'm so grateful. Cynthia and Meghan, who only met today, have been working together by email and phone and whatever for weeks and months to help to create this beautiful, dramatic presentation we saw. And they found these actors and singer and pianist who made such a wonderful evening. So I'm really so grateful to all of you. But to further answer your question, I mean, we're coming to a time. I mean, I'm not ashamed to say I was born in 1942. And I would be one of the, you know, if I were, I was born here in America, but if I was a Holocaust survivor, yeah, I could be, but I would have been an infant. And so now we have like these child Holocaust, people who were, the survivors were children, okay?
Child survivors
who were not children. They're, you know, my age or in the vicinity. Some of them older, some of them in their 80s, and they were children. So we need dramatization in the future. We need the emotion of it beside the practicality and the material of it to carry forward for Yom HaShoah and every day of the year, the memory of the Holocaust and of the victims, because that's what we're going to have in the future. And I think it's totally very, very important.
I couldn't agree more. Can we raise the lights a bit and see if there are any questions? I think there might be some questions.
First of all, I'm the daughter of a Holocaust survivor. Sorry. This was very moving. I'm one of the people to whom Rachel referred. My mother survived Majdanek, Auschwitz, Ravensbrück, and Neustadt-Glava. She was one of 3,000 women that the Germans used as hostages to march without shoes from Auschwitz to Ravensbrück, although she was given two left shoes by Israel Gutman, who founded Yad Vashem, who was her friend. Anyway, so I have lived what you're doing. This is my life, remembering, I lost my mother 3 months ago, remembering and figuring out how to properly honor her is now my life. So my question to you three, since we heard Rochelle's answer, is why did you decide to embark on this very painful journey that I live every day?
May I start? Let me tell you, I'm a German professor, and my specialty was exile literature. And what I found was that in the, and it's not with malice, but as researchers working on German exile leaving, that there wasn't any narrative about the Holocaust. And it made me very angry. And so it's not that I left exile, but I sort of started to switch because I found that there was a big gap in the understanding, a kind of pretending, you know, Germans left and the intelligentsia left, and yeah, but what is the other part? So I decided to do this. And in the beginning, you know, in the late 80s, there was not much out there. And I'm very happy I did, because it is exactly to honor your mother.
The play at the end, the poem at the end is from this play of mine called Silence, Not a Love Story. And it's about a woman who, a Jewish German woman who was a resistor and along with a Catholic man. And I think like a lot of people who grew up in the Jewish community or just in general, you have to think about what would I do? And how would I survive? What would be my choices? And I became very captivated by her decision to be become involved in an anti-Nazi movement well before the Nazis took hold. And it was like, how did she know? You know, what did they learn? And she was part of a small group called the ISK, which was a small political party, and they analyzed things along these lines. What do we know? What can we do? And what should we hope? And I thought, this is something I can carry with me. And if I can help people understand their circumstances and what was happening in the world and how they took some sort of action at that time, then maybe people will be inspired in our own time to be active and take a step for human rights. So I come very much from a human rights perspective, and there's so many amazing stories of people who were bold and courageous and acted out of conviction and love. And I have, this Gisa Kanapka was in, she and they survived, and they moved to Minnesota and got married, and she was a professor there for a long time and died about 2003. But she had this one quote that I just loved, and it says, I want to convey a basic conviction about human beings. They carry in them the seeds of destruction as well as great love and giving. It will depend on us, each person within each generation at all times, what we help to bring forth. This is an unending task. So that's where I was coming from.
I think ultimately I try to be a supremely hopeful person. And so my commitment to this project and to my students and to those whom the project reached was that this could be anyone at any time, and that we cannot wait for that to happen, nor can we think it will always be someone else, that we have to be proactive in understanding our shared history and honoring those who were lost and the lives of those who survived, and that's something that is our responsibility. And I don't think a lot of my students would have maybe thought of it in that way, but I think that using theater as an introduction to the Holocaust, but also to the idea of them as citizens and what that might mean in terms of looking after others and exercising compassion and being someone who has a voice and can make that voice heard and stand in solidarity was a profound experience for me. And it's something that I want to encourage in all of my students, always, so that your mother's life is always honored and is also always both a lesson to others and in a way also a warning that will always hang over our heads if we're really cognizant people who are aware of what's happening around us. And it's something that we have to take to heart and move forward with that. And it's both supremely hopeful because we can do something about it, but it's also, in a way, I guess it's somewhat darker in a way because it does have to stay with us. I don't know if that makes sense. That's sort of how I've... Okay, thank you.
Meghan, I was wondering if you had videotaped the performances.
We did. We have one videotaped performance. Our theater facility is not as videotape friendly as some others, but we do have one videotape performance that a couple of students did and edited together for us for our own archive. So we do have one.
Because I was thinking, hearing what Sonja was saying, how to find a play having to do with women for her students, that if you could make that available somehow, that through the resource handbook, it might be a really wonderful thing.
That, I think that's a great idea, Liz, because for us, it, we wouldn't, you know, be able to stage it, but for ideas and discussion, if we could see it, that absolutely, it would be great.
We absolutely can investigate that. The number of rights required to mount the production, we have the Tillion Association, La Martiniere, who published the French version, the two French translators, Jonathan, who adapted the English lyrics for it, Modo, and there's one other one. There are several French and German organizations from whom we had to get permission. It took almost a year just to get the rights to the production. But I will go for it. I like a challenge. I think I could use that as a precursor to, can we have the rights for this educational module? And maybe what would I need to do to remount the production somewhere else? I don't. My French isn't good. I think eventually they gave up on me and were like, yeah, that lady in Maine, just tell her yes already and tell her to stop emailing us. That worked for me.
Yes. Hi. I have more of a comment than a question. Along with making these stories available in academia, I think it's crucial to include them in popular culture and expand them outside of schoolrooms and reaching more people, particularly as survivors die off. For instance, there's now a lot of revisionism going on about the Inquisition. That, well, it wasn't as bad as we've been told. The numbers were not as big in terms of the people burned or slaughtered in any way, you know, that kind of thing. And it's frightening to read things like that and see what is already going on with people who have the documentation in front of them who claim that it doesn't exist. And I can just give one example. I'm a playwright, and I cast a play some years ago with a woman named Camille Torres playing a Jewish character. And she came into the second rehearsal, and she was so excited. She said, I called my mother in New Mexico, where I'm from, to tell her all about the play that I'm cast in. And she said, good, it's time that I tell you that you're Jewish. And every rehearsal, she kept coming in with, you know, there's a whole organization I can join. There's a convention I'm going to go to. And I didn't know Torres was a Jewish name. And it just went on. And I think that one of the most exciting things for me as a playwright, writing historical plays with a lot of Jewish characters, is people in the audience coming up and saying, I didn't know that. And so the work that you all are doing to promote these stories using culture and art is just, it's so crucial, and I thank you all for doing
that. Thank you, thank you. I think we have time for one more. If there are no more, sir.
I think implicit in some of the comments that I've heard is, well, at least it rang a resonant chord in my mind. My two daughters both went to college, both reported back about terrible events, if not outright anti-Semitism, at least total misunderstanding and not understanding anything about Jewish history. And I certainly do agree with the comments that were made that this kind of work has got to go beyond just a few colleges. I'm thinking it's probably just too enormous a task, but to somehow involve the history departments of colleges and to challenge them across the entire country, that to make this curriculum an absolute required part of the curriculum, and to make sure that every freshman gets this before they start listening to all of the other nonsense which they're going to hear, because there's a lot of stuff out there. What's happening recently up in out in Berkeley was absolutely terrible, with a person who had an ISIS flag, and he could just fly it with no problem whatsoever. I mean, one young man had the Israeli flag, and people immediately surrounded him and were booing him and were jeering at him. this is what is happening on many, many campuses, and I think this kind of curriculum really is so important to spread.
Thank you very much. I thank you all for coming. I hope for those new to our theater here, this auditorium, I hope you'll come back and join us. If you haven't signed up to be on the American Jewish Historical Society's email list, I encourage you to do so. We have a wonderful slate of public programs on the horizon for the rest of the year. And again, join us outside, please. And I think, you know, the Center for Jewish History is exactly the place where this should be launched and where this discourse should happen. And I encourage you all to come back again and again.
Rachel, so, yeah. I just want to thank you and Rochelle putting this together. It was really wonderful.
I mean, thank you. Thank you.